I invite Nikhil and Anuj also to come, and also
thank you, Anuj, Nikhil. Gautam. You all can leave. Shaban Azmi stays on stage. Baba Azmi, Tanvi Azmi, Shaban Azmi have all collectively worked very hard, tirelessly, and passionately to make Kaifi Azmi centenary year very, very special. And now we wait to listen from a daughter, a special daughter, on her special father.
खवातीन हजरात आदाब, बहुत बहुत शुक्रिया कि इतनी जल्दी सुबह में आप सब लोग यहाँ इतनी बड़ी तादाद में आए हैं. मैं आपकी बहुत शुक्रगुजार हूँ. दरअसल जो छोटी छोटी तकरीरें यहाँ हुई तो मुझे ऐसा लगता है कि हमारे अंदर सिर्फ जो हम प्रोफेशन करते हैं वही नहीं, उसके अलावा एक शायर भी होता है. क्योंकि जिस तरह से निखिल रंजन और अनुज पोद्दार ने अपनी बातें कही तो वो बिल्कुल मुझे ऐसा लग रहा था कि शायरी कर रहे थे. तो थैंक यू फॉर योर ब्यूटीफुल वर्ड्स. विशाल, यू हैव वर्क सो हार्ड. इट हैज बीन जस्ट अ जर्नी ऑफ सच पैशन, एंड आई नो दैट यू हैव बीन सपोर्टेड बाय द स्पॉन्सर्स, बाय योर फैमिली, एंड देन माय डॉटर नम्रता एंड हर टीम हु हैव रियली वर्क्ड वेरी हार्ड फॉर दिस. थैंक यू वेरी मच. सिर्फ ये तय पाया था कि आज क्योंकि पेन फेस्टिवल कैफी साहब के नाम पर 100 स्पेशल एडिशन पेन्स निकाल रहे हैं, तो वो क्यों निकाल रहे हैं उसकी ज़रा सी बात मैं आपको बताना चाहती हूँ. कैफी आजमी साहब जो हैं उनको मटेरियल चीज़ों से कोई दिलचस्पी नहीं थी. वो सिर्फ एक कुर्ता पजामा पहनते थे, काफ़ी बार ट्रेन से ट्रैवल करते थे. ना उन्होंने कभी घड़ी पहनी, ना कोई अंगूठी पहनी, ना चेन पहनी. उनको मटेरियल चीज़ों से कोई दिलचस्पी नहीं थी. उनको दिलचस्पी थी और जिसको वो वैल्यू करते थे वो था उनका कम्युनिस्ट पार्टी का कार्ड, उनकी 5000 किताबें और उनके पेन. पेन के मामले में वो सचमुच ग्रीडी आदमी थे. सिर्फ फाउंटेन पेन से लिखते थे, सिर्फ ब्लैक इंक या ब्लू ब्लैक इंक से लिखते थे. और जितनी बार मैं आती थी बाहर से कहते थे मेरा पेन, और मैं कहती थी अब कितने पेन मैं आखिर आपको दे सकती हूँ, अब हर बार आऊंगी तो पेन दूंगी. एंड ही यूज्ड टू टेक दोस पेन्स, कीप देम. ही यूज्ड टू स्टोर देम इन अ वुडन कश्मीरी बॉक्स विद सम फिलिग्री. एवरी नाउ एंड देन ही वुड टेक दोस पेन्स आउट, क्रेस देम वेरी लविंगली, रिमूव द इंक, क्लीन देम, पुट देम बैक अगेन टिल ही कुड डू इट. देन आफ्टर ही गॉट पैरालाइज्ड आई यूज्ड टू हेल्प हिम डू दैट. He used to also send his pen to a fountain pen hospital in New York, which I didn't know. तो मैं बोलती थी अच्छे कम्युनिस्ट हैं आप, फाउंटेन पेन आप न्यूयॉर्क भेज रहे हैं, 18 मोब्लांग पेन आपके पास है. तो कहते थे एक अमीर मेरी बेटी और बहुत सारे दोस्त हैं जो अमीर हैं. और फिर कर ऐसा हुआ कि मैं जो हूँ, मेरे किसी फ्रेंड ने मुझे एक मोब्लांग पेन देखा, तो उन्होंने कहा तुमको क्यों देखा, तुमको क्यों दिया, तुम क्या करोगी इसका. तो मैंने कहा मैं भी लिखती हूँ पेन से. तो उन्होंने फौरन मुझसे वो ले लिया और फिर मेरे फ्रेंड को एक बहुत खूबसूरत खत, और वो भी पोएट्री में लिखा कि वो पेन क्यों उनके साथ ज्यादा बेहतर है बजाय मेरे. तो ऑब्वियसली मेरे फ्रेंड जो है बहुत एक्साइटेड हो गए कि दैट वाज द करेक्ट थिंग टू डू. हम हमेशा ये कहते हैं कि द पेन इज माइटियर देन द सॉर्ड. आई सॉ माय फादर प्रैक्टिसिंग दैट. ही यूज्ड हिज पेन to great advantage. One of the advantages I just told you, ke mera pen pinch karne ke liye unhone apna ek sher likh diya aur wo pen kha liya. Ek 40 baras ke baad jab wo apne chote se gaon Mijwa mein gaye, to unhone dekha ki ye gaon jisme unki paidaish hui thi wo waqt mein bilkul munjamit hai, aur unhone tay kiya ki ab iske bawajood ke unko brain hemorrhage hua, unka left arm aur left leg फॉर लाइफ पैरालाइज था, उन्होंने ये तय किया कि वो अपने गांव में जाकर और वहाँ काम करेंगे. उस जमाने में मिजवा इतना छोटा सा गांव था दैट इट डिडंट इवन हैव अ पिन कोड. कैवी साहब ने अपना फाउंटेन पेन लिया और मुझे मोहसिना पिदवाई बताती हैं उस जमाने में वो टेली कम्युनिकेशंस मिनिस्टर थी, और उनको कैफी साहब ने एक खत लिखा जो पूरा का पूरा शायरी में था, जो बेसिकली एक नज़्म थी जिसमें उन्होंने कहा कि मिजवा को एक सब पोस्ट ऑफिस की कितनी ज़रूरत है, इतने चार्म्ड हुई मोहसिना किदवाई कि उन्होंने कहा कि मैंने सब रूल्स तोड़ के सिर्फ उस नज़्म के लिए मैंने वहाँ एक सब पोस्ट ऑफिस लगा दिया. सो दैट इज द पावर ऑफ द पेन. लेट मी टेल यू दैट ऑल द पीपल हु आर हियर हु आर रिसिपिएंट्स ऑफ द स्पेशल एडिशन पेन टुडे आर पीपल हु हैड अ वेरी वेरी ब्यूटिफुल एंड पर्सनल रिलेशनशिप विद कैफी साहब एंड आई एम वेरी ग्रेटफुल टू देम दैट दे हैव एक्सेप्टेड दिस पेन. आई वुड लाइक टू टेल यू अबाउट माय फ्रेंड भावना सुमाया. भावना सुमाया ने आपको बताया उनका क्या रिश्ता था कैफी साहब से. उन्होंने ये नहीं बताया कि वो बिल्कुल एक निडर खातून है जिनका नाम है भावना सुमाया. अच्छे अच्छे मेरे जो दोस्त हैं वो उर्दू में बात करते हुए घबराते हैं, खासतौर से कैफी साहब के साथ, नॉट माई फ्रेंड भावना सुमाया. हमारे यहाँ एक कहावत है कि जब जब आप ये कहते हैं कि somebody is really sort of absolutely क्या कहना चाहिए उसको, लट्टू हो गया, सपोजिंग कोई लट्टू हो गया किसी पे, तो वो कहते थे कि देखिए इनको जो है ना उल्लू का गोश्त खिला दिया है. ये है कहा, ये है महावरा, ऑब्सेस्ड हो गए. तो आपके जो फ्रेंड विनोद खन्ना है वो उस जमाने में रजनीश के यहाँ चले गए थे, तो भावना जी बैठी हुई इंतहा कॉन्फिडेंस से कैफी साहब के साथ कहती, अब्बा मुझे ऐसा लगता है कि विनोद खन्ना को रजनीश ने आलू का दोस्त खिला दिया है. और इनको बिल्कुल भी कोई तकल्लुफ नहीं हुआ कि मैं गलत जबान बोलती हूँ. तो इनका ये खास रिश्ता था और इसलिए ये बहुत जरूरी था कि आज का ये फंक्शन ये कंपेयर करें. थैंक यू वेरी मच फॉर कमिंग. प्लीज फॉर दी एवी टू बी श्योर. थैंक यू.
Extreme right, Mahesh Bhatt, who has written films he has directed and also films that he has not directed. Pritish Nandi, who is a poet, a painter, art collector, and also a journalist, columnist, everything. Javed Akhtar ki kya tarif kare? तारीफ करो क्या उसकी. सबको उनकी पोइट्री के बारे में पता है, सबको उनके गाने के बारे में पता है, सबको उनके स्क्रिप्ट्स के बारे में पता है. और आज भी मैं कहती हूँ कि मोगैम्बो मैं इसलिए खुश हूँ क्योंकि मेरे पास जावेद अख्तर है. ब्रिटिश, आई वुड लाइक टू बिगिन विद यू. How did you really meet Kaifi Azmi? And I want to know in which language you have communicated, because you don't know a word of Urdu. At least I know one or two words. And Kaifi Saab didn't speak in English.
I come from Calcutta, and believe it or not, I was once 21. That's when I met. I was a poet at 21. I'd done about 15 books by then. And among other things, I had an audience who would listen to me rather rapidly in those days. Because poetry meant something to the people of I met him in a mushaira. For some strange reason, I used to be invited to at various mushairas where I would speak my poems. Kaifi was the star of that particular mushaira. We enjoyed each other's poetry. I don't know how, but we did. Bhavna is not particularly accurate when she says, I don't know Urdu. I don't know word of Urdu. I was at that time, when I was 21, married to a young lady who only spoke Urdu. So I had no option but to try and understand what she was saying, if nothing else. So I managed to communicate with Kaifi, and he managed to communicate with me. My inadequate Urdu and his faltering English met somewhere. And our poetry reached out and crossed languages to reach the audiences out there, which who were in thousands. And it always amazed me why a huge Bengali audience would be listening to Kaifi or listening to me, both of us not reading poetry in Bengali. But we understood the magic and the power of this when in a few months of our friendship, and I would consider my friendship with Kaifi as, I would consider Kaifi as my best friend ever. He and I were great friends. There's an obvious difference in age, but we were great friends, possibly best friends. And within a few months of our knowing each other, happened the Bangladesh War. People crossed over. A lot of them stayed with me in the house where I live, in Park Circuit, which is just close to the Pakistan High Commission. Within a few months, couple of months, the Pakistan High Commission became the Bangladesh High Commission. And the young boy who was staying with me, who had very seriously injured his arm while throwing a grenade, fell in love with the Bangladesh High Commissioner's daughter, who was formerly the Pakistan High Commissioner. And they got married in my house. So I had the whole Bangladesh cabinet out there. Kaifi was always there. Kaifi and I then traveled into Bangladesh during the war. I remember Sukhdev was there at that time, a great friend of Kaifi's, who recorded some of those journeys. And I translated a lot of poems from Bangladesh, which he brought out in an international edition and raised a lot of money. Kaifi and I did mushairas, we raised money, and we raised public opinion for Bangladesh. They needed both at that time. Kaifi wrote a poem on Bangladesh, which was a phenomenal poem. I wrote a book on Bangladesh, a book of poems on Bangladesh. I published, I translated the top poets and put them together, and another poet, Thambi Muttu, Sri Lankan poet, brought them out from London. And suddenly, Bangladesh was everywhere. And I then realized that the power of language, that a nation could fight tyranny, could fight an oppressive regime just because its students refused to give up their love for their language. When I look at the way we treat our students today in India, we call them all kinds of things. We demean their politics. We insult what they stand for. Students always stand in defiance of the system. But in that defiance lies the change that society undergoes. In Bangladesh, it was those students, those very same students, who raised the banner of revolt. It was not the fighters, the guerrillas, who were fighting the government out there. It was the students who were fighting. They were winning hearts, winning support of the people. All they had was a language. That was the magic. And both of us, I think, very strongly bonded during that time. We went out together there. I could see the poems on that. He wrote a lot of poems on that. But it was the sheer magic of that event made us best friends.
Can I ask you to recite the poem that you translated of Kavi Azmi?
Okay. The one that I translated, I don't, I translated many, but the one that I would have read, I don't have here.
You can choose one that you are very proud of.
Shabana has been very kind enough to send me some. I tend to look. Does it work?
Put that on, please.
I tend to lose my books. That's always a problem with me. Since we were talking about Bangladesh, let me read this poem on Bangladesh. I am not a country that you can set me ablaze. I am not a wall you can raise to the ground, nor a frontier you can obliterate. This obsolete map of the world spread before you on the table is only a maze of wavered lines. How can you find me here? How can you find me here? I am the passion of the obsessed, the deathless dream of the oppressed. When man bleeds his fellow men, when exploitation crosses all limits, and tyranny breaks all bounds, I suddenly appear in one corner. I had eyes within some heart. You must have seen me before. Sometimes in the east and sometimes in the west. In cities and in villages where there are people or even in the wilderness. I have only a past and no geography. My history is forbidden to be taught. People read it in hiding. I am both the victor and the vanquished. I execute my own murders, and sometimes I am myself crucified. The only difference is my murderers die. I do not. I cannot die. How senseless you are. The tanks you have received as arms, you roll them onto my heart. All day and night, you rain napalm on me. Listen. Listen. You will tire one day. How will you shackle my hands? My hands are 40 million. Which head will you wax? I have 70 million heads on my shoulder.
I now focus on Mahesh Bhatt. Mahesh in the 80s was Mahesh, and then in the 90s and the 2000s he became Bhatsa.
You made me that. You won't be today publicly.
But he's one of Shabana's favorite friends, and I remember that at the time I was becoming friends with Shabana, you were always there at Janki Kutir, often chatting with Kevin Saab. And my favorite memories and images are that Kefi Saab would be in the garden saying something in his very soft voice, and then Mahesh would sit across him. Slowly his eyes will start twinkling, he will raise his hands up and rest it behind his head, and then in between he will steal glances with Shabana, because they both were understanding something, of course, which I was not. What fascinated you with Kefi Saab? And you were always listening to him very intently every time you came home.
Behind that personality of a poet, there was an essence which was embedded there. You know, it was much more than the poet that the world called him. I'm not comfortable with this word called the poet. You cannot just call him a poet. He was a mystic for me. There was a kind of a roaring silence that I heard in him. Whenever I was around him, I could feel that kind of a silence that engulfed me, and he could absorb my noise. My restlessness was something that he embraced, and he gave me the most, see, the attention is the most generous gift that your human being can give to another human being. When you are down there struggling and looking for a place in the sun, he had those eyes, he had that generosity to see in me something which the world could not see or did not want to see or did not have the ability to see. He had the silence because he was not full of himself. He was looking at life. He was drinking from the wells of tomorrow. And I represented that to him. And whenever I walked in, he smiled. He saw what I could detect him in Pratish's translation. Wherever he saw a spark of rebellion, wherever he saw audacity, he saw with audacity vulnerability also, because he could feel that this person who's being audacious is being very vulnerable. He'll be trampled upon, he'll be spat upon. And his hands reached out to protect me. And for me, that was Kefi Saab. For me, the defining image of Kefi Saab is when the history of this nation changed post the Babri Masjid demolition. He was in Janki Kutir one evening, and I was worried about him. And I remember going there to see him. He was there in the lawns. There was the sunlight, he was backlit, and there was his paraphernalia of his tea that was there. He sat down with a kind of a sadness which you normally see in the church on the face of Jesus. And that was courage for me. When everybody was rolling his window and locking his door, here was the icon called Kefi Azmi, who was the heartbeat of India, who represented the plurality, who said, I will sit down here in my lawn without raising the walls. That ability to be trampled upon for what he stood for was courage for me. That was living, palpable courage for me. And that is what Kefi Saab means to me. The audacity, he was an embodiment of audacity. So don't trivialize the persona of that man by calling him a poet. A poet is just one dimension of him. His essence was like life. You can't put a full stop on life. You can't put a full stop on Kefi. He is much bigger than the definition that we seek out to give to him.
every time one meets you, you know, you fill us with so much passion. There's so much energy and passion within you. And like you rightly said, that Kefi Saab had gentleness, silence, generosity. I used to feel that affection is such a wonderful thing because it makes no intellectual discrimination. I didn't understand Urdu poetry, I was not anywhere. But I would be sitting there and he would be reciting his poem and I would not understand and look quite dumb. And then he would try to explain, then when he failed with his thing, then he looked at Shabana or then Javed Saab and then they explained it. So one understood. And now the thing is, the legacy has been carried forward. With Javed Saab, so many times he explains something to us, we don't understand, then he brings himself so much lower to make us understand. So my focus is now on Javed Saab. You know, I find it very interesting, Javed Saab, that when you came to Bombay to make your career in cinema, Kefi Saab must have been an important lyricist by then. You have watched him on the sidelines, then you were a struggling writer, a successful writer. You knew him as a poet because your father is also a poet. And then you get married to her, Shabana. So your relationship has gone through so many changes. I would like to know about the phases. I never had the opportunity to ask, though I always wanted to know.
You know, quite often people ask me, when did you meet Kefi Saab for the first time? I don't remember that. I have no memory of him. Like I don't have any memory when I met my father or my mother for the first time. Or say, Sahil Saab or Krishan Chand or Majru. Or Ismat Chukta, I have no memory when I met them for the first time. Actually, I think I met them when I couldn't even remember. I didn't know who they were. I was born, fortunate enough to be born in that clan. And I knew them from above. My first vague memory that I must be 4 years old or five is that I had come to Bombay with my mother. We were staying somewhere in Ismat Appa's house. And then we visited Kefi Saab's house. That time Kefi Saab was there, but not there, but even at the age of four, I knew it is Kefi Saab's house. And I remembered the house, the detail, where the bed was, where the paintings were, where was the table, where was the kitchen, and so on. So when I described that house to Shaukat Appa, and then she gave me the days, so I was around four. But I had a memory. It means at the age of four, I knew Kefi Saab is someone important. Then obviously one knew him through his poetry. Like one learned about Krishnaji through his short stories and novels. Then I came to Bombay, and then Bombay, like any normal son, I didn't have good relations with my father. So I was on my own. And they were my father's friends. So I had to keep in my own little mind when I was 19, 20, that my dignity did not allow me to go to any one of them and say, I am so and so's son. And they were seeing me after so many years that they wouldn't recognize me. So I was working with Kamal Saab as an assistant director. At a salary of 50 rupees per month. So sometimes he used to give me letters giving the details that what kind of a song he wants, what is the detail of the situation. So Kefi Saab was writing song for Kamal Saab. So that was Pakistan. So I would go to the house, hand over that letter, but would never tell them who I am. Because, I mean, that was my idea of self-respect. But then I started getting some work and I saw Heer Raja and then Garam Hawa. Those films influenced me so much. Although I remembered his poetry, I knew Kefi Saab as a poet, as a person. But in spite of that, these were two things which pushed me so hard towards him. So I started meeting. And I went to introduce myself and then I developed an individual relationship. I had started writing poetry. I started writing poetry at an age where generally people stop writing poetry.
because I didn't want to sit on that baap ki dukaan, to isliye nahi likhi thi. To ultimately likhne lage. So I would, there were very few people who knew I write poetry, because I was a closet poet for quite some time. So I would recite this poetry to Rahi Sahab, my very close associate, senior, but a friend, Yash Chopra, and Kaifi Sahab, and Dharamveer Bhandi. So Kaifi Sahab encouraged me a lot, never corrected me. In a very subtle manner, sometimes he used to give me an advice or point out things that you think about it. He won't say that this is wrong and change it this way. And he gave me a very good example. He said that if you don't become full of yourself, you don't get satisfied with yourself as a poet, and keep learning and keep trying, the plant will keep on growing on its own. And the leaves, which are not perfect, will dry down and fall on their own. You don't have to do anything about it. One thing that I would like to mention about Kaifi Sahab, this is something that perhaps everybody knows, but then too I always say, and I repeat it, that generally it is believed, and rightly so, that there is a lot of difference between the karni and kathani of the poets. And it's totally understandable. I have nothing against that. Because their kathani is so good that it is not possible to turn it into karni. It's very difficult. But here was a person who had no contradiction between his belief as a poet and his value system as a person. If he wrote about women empowerment, this idea did not stop at the door of his house. If he believed in, wrote about secularism, it was not a slogan for him, but a way of life. If he wrote about the farmers and workers, he worked among them, he lived among them. And I had only one expression, however humble it is, was my poetry. So now instead of talking, I would like to recite a poem which, in which I have tried to express what I have seen or what I have felt about it.
Irshad.
I'm very impressed. Now, this is the fourth version. Jim.
Raja sends a message to the
whole film was in poetry. Usse kehna ki wo mera ek khwab hai, jo tamakta hai dil mein wo mehtab hai. Usse kehna ki gehun ke kheton ka rang, dil milati hui titliyon ki umang. Usse kehna ki jhoolon ki shehnaiyan और रंगी दुपट्टों की अंगड़ाइयां. उससे कहना कि चक्की के बाटों का राग लड़खड़ाती जवानी मचलता सुहाग. उससे कहना कि दुल्हन के काजल की प्यास, पहले बोसे की गर्म और ठंडी मिठास. इतनी रंगीनियों को जो यकजा किया, ईर कुदरत ने तब तुझको पैदा किया. Now here is my humble tribute to him, or whatever Pratish has said and Mahesh has said, this is in meter, that's all they have said. Ajeeb aadmi tha wo, mohabbaton ka geet tha, bagawaton ka raag tha, kabhi wo sirf phool tha, कभी वो सिर्फ आग था. अजीब आदमी था. वो मुफलिसों से कहता था कि दिन बदल भी सकते हैं, वो जाबिरों से कहता था तुम्हारे सर पे सोने के जो ताज है कभी पिघल भी सकते। वो बंदिशों से कहता था मैं तुमको तोड़ सकता, सहूलतों से कहता था मैं तुमको छोड़ सकता, हवाओं से वो कहता था मैं तुमको मोड़ सकता। वो ख्वाब से ये कहता था कि तुझको सच करूंगा मैं, वारदू से कहता था मैं तेरा हम सफर हूं तेरे साथ ही चलूंगा मैं, तू चाहे जितनी दूर बना ले अपनी मंजिलें कभी नहीं थकूंगा मैं। वो जिंदगी से कहता था कि तुझको मैं सजाऊंगा, तू मुझसे चांद मांग ले मैं चांद लेके आऊंगा। वो आदमी से कहता था कि आदमी से प्यार कर, उछल रही है ये जमीन कुछ इसका अब सिंगार कर। अजीब आदमी था वो जिंदगी के सारे गम तमाम दुख हर एक सितम से कहता था मैं तुमसे जीत जाऊंगा, कि तुमको तो मिटा ही देगा एक रोज आदमी, भुला ही देगा ये जहां, मेरी अलग है दास्तां। वो आंखें जिनमें ख्वाब है, वो दिल है जिनमें धड़कने, वो बाजू जिनमें है सकत, वो ओंठ जिन पे लफ्ज है, रहूंगा उनके दरमियान कि जब मैं बीत जाऊंगा। अजीब आदमी था।
इट इज नाउ टाइम फॉर द पेन्स टू बी प्रेजेंटेड टू यू, सो मे विल यू राइज गाइस। Shabana Azmi, Tanvi Azmi, please come on the stage. Tanvi Azmi, will you please stand? Somebody should come from that side and you should come from that side. Tanvi Azmi, please.
Very good friends with Sukhdev. And this is, I think, around early 1970s. And it was of an evening when both of them were very drunk. And the time when they were, I can't quite remember what happened, but I know for a fact that Gary and I sort of took Sukhdev all the way back to his home, and Sukhdev's wife wouldn't allow him to come back. That's the one little thing I remember of that particular evening. But you know, the devil person was extraordinary because, you know, I mean, if he had lived, he would have been 100 years old. But he was forever young. Mentally, it was quite extraordinary because I'm talking of a time when Sukhdev was still around. This must have been about mid-1970s. And Kapil Sahib, of course, whatever his age was. But he was like a child. You know, it was just, that's my one memory of him, which was quite marvelous. And I will continue to remember him like that because, you know, he and I, we tried to work together. He was writing a couple of scripts for me, which didn't quite work. He wrote the dialogue for Manthan, and we were there in that village in Sanganwa together. And that was a marvelous time also because he was an absolute delight, really, more than anything else. Thank you.
Thank you, Shyam Babu.
I don't know how to say anything about this incredible giant of a human being. My earliest memory of him, of course, is when he and my father, Mr. Laraka, worked together. My father would compose the tune, and Kefi Saab would write the words, and I, as a 9 or 10 year old, would, the bass part of the tabla, the dagga, would sit there and play the theka. So that's one thing I remember. I think my first memory is, and I can only compare it now to something that is one of the most incredible sight on this earth, is when he walked into the room, it was like Mount Kilimanjaro just walked in. I mean, he filled the room up. And it was like when he walked in, there was, as Maheshji said, backlit. His shadow was everywhere, along with him, his physical self. And so it was an overwhelming presence to see. It was a giant, and when you looked at him, we're looking at the heavens and the sky, and totally in the presence of something to be revered, some personality to be prayed to, and that's Kefi Saab. And I remember playing theka, and he was writing, and what I think the couplet was, "Tere bagair jeene mein lazzat nahi rahi, ab zindagi ki koi zarurat nahi rahi."
Thank you, Zakir Hussain. May I now invite on stage the beautiful and the artistic Anuradha Parikh.
Anuradha Parikh is also a recipient of this very special pen because she had, again, a very silent but beautiful relationship with Kefi Saab. You know that Kefi Saab had a weakness for good looks, and so now you know why Anuradha is there. But I promise you, apart from good looks, she has a lot of talent as well. So we are very proud, Tanvi and I, on behalf of the Azmis.
And also, Ram Gandhi, the dynamic and savvy Ram Gandhi, on stage, please.
Thank you. To say something, yes. Ram Gandhi, like Vishal told you, Ram and I and all of us have been friends for 100 years now, but it was really Vishal who had been going from pillar to pole, finding somebody to support him for the festival, and it was Ram who did the due diligence and then got in touch with me and then said, all right, this man is bona fide, you can carry on with him. So thank you very much, Ram. This is from the family. Thank you. Thank you so much. Anuradha, just say a few words. Nita. The very silent daughter-in-law to speak her heart out while I will remain silent.
Okay. I don't think anybody knows me as silent, but here goes. Today I've heard a lot of you speak about Abba in different ways, different aspects about him. There is something about Abba that is extremely personal to me. I can't call him Kefi Saab to begin with. The amount of love that I have received after I got married didn't let me miss the presence of my father. When I got married, of course, it was an extremely controversial marriage. It was a Hindu-Muslim marriage, and there was lots of, everything was aflame, and we were getting a lot of calls. And I remember my first impression of Abba, and he said, "Beta, main yahan lawn pe baithunga aur main dekhunga kaun aata hai jo tumhara ek bhi baal baaka kar sake." And I will protect you for the rest of my life as long as I live. He also had this extremely flirtatious relationship with his daughter and his daughter-in-law, and he used to often call me.
मुझे अब्बा जो है हमेशा अपना गुलाब का फूल कहते थे, या तो चिड़िया कहते थे या गुलाब का फूल,
और मुझे दुल्हन पाशा। तो ये हमारी लड़ाई चलती रहती थी हमेशा, दैट अब्बा लव्स शवाना मो, अब्बा लव्स तन्नी मो।
तो एक मर्तबा ऐसे हुआ कि मैं दरवाजा बंद था और अब्बा और तन्नी अंदर कमरे में थे, तो मैं कान लगा के सुन रही थी कि कैफी साहब क्या कह रहे थे।
तो अब्बा मुझे प्यार से बोल रहे थे, मेरे दुल्हन पाशा, तुम मेरे गुलाब के फूल।
तो जब मैं अंदर गई और मैंने कहा, आप मुझे कहते हो हमेशा कि मैं गुलाब का फूल हूं और अब आप इसको कह रहे हो, तो कहते,
बेटे नहीं नहीं, मैं तो इसको गोभी का फूल कह रहा हूं। So this is how he was. This is an aspect of Kefi Saab. He used to like to all have all his children around. I remember there was this entire day that Baba spent with him. None of the talkative women were allowed. And he spent the entire day with him from 10 o'clock in the morning to 5 o'clock in the evening. The only sentence that was exchanged between the two of them was, बेटे खाना लग गया, खाना खा ले जी अब्बा। दे सैट डाउन इन टोटल साइलेंस, बोथ फादर एंड सन एट देयर मील एट 5 o'clock, बाबा लेफ्ट फ्रॉम देयर। देयर वाज वन मोर स्टोरी दैट आईड लाइक टू टेल यू। दिस वाज व्हेन बाबा एंड मायसेल्फ शिफ्टेड आउट ऑफ जानकी गुडीर एंड वी वर स्टेइंग इन एट आवर ओन प्लेस। वन मॉर्निंग आई कॉल्ड अप मम्मी एंड आई सेड, मम्मी क्या कर रहे हैं आप? सो दे हैड दिस रिचुअल इन द मॉर्निंग, मम्मी एंड अब्बा वुड सिट विद देयर इलैबोरेट चाय की ट्रे एंड मम्मी वुड, after giving many instructions even to herself, ki chai dam hone do aur isme chamcha chala do and wo sab karke, and she was giving Abba his chai. So I called her up and I said, mummy aap kya kar rahe ho? She said, bete main sannate mein chai pee rahi hu. Then she turned around and she said, aap kya kar rahe ho? Maine kaha main aapke bete ke sath sannate mein chai pee rahi hu. And for the next 45 minutes, mother-in-law and daughter-in-law were talking to each other because the husbands refused to have anything to do with them. So Abba's memory of his writing and his relationship with his pens is something that I've also seen. I remember that wooden box of his with that red felt inside. And I don't think he's looked at his children with as much love as he did at his pens. One day he called me because he used to just like me to sit in front of him for some reason. So he was writing on Tatya Tope. So he said, "Iska pad lo Hindi mein hai, main pad nahi pa raha." So I started reading it out to him, and he started making his points with his pen. So I said, "Abba, aap kitna khoobsurat likhte hain." So he said, "Bete, isme meri koi, I have nothing to do with it. Ye to sirf pen ka kamal hai." That's the person he was, because he never took credit for anything that he did. Most of you have said that he was never full of himself, because he was far bigger than himself. And his ideologies and his beliefs were far bigger than him. And I'm so blessed and I'm so proud to have had him as my father. Thank you. And now to the most important writer amongst us, Bhavna Somaiya, with her special relationship with Kepi Azmi. Both Tanvi and I would like to give this gift. Thank you. Wonderful audience. We've taken a little bit more time than we had promised, but thank you from the bottom of our hearts. Thank you, William Penn. Thank you, Kanko. Thank you, Vishal Singh. And thank you. We have, Vishal is here, and there are some people who put together a very beautiful exhibition. We want one group picture of all the people who've got the pens, and the rest of them, please watch the exhibition, because this is really quite wonderful. Do you want them to climb up again, or shall I just light them here, please? Here, here. We'll light them here, please. Come.
Yes, look here, ma'am. Excuse me.
Thank you. Thank you.
Guys, this is for you all. Can I give one each to everybody?
Thank you.
कैफी साहब की यादों को हम ताज़ा कर रहे थे. ये एक मौका था कि हम वो सोच जो है वो जिसको वो सिंबलाइज करते थे उसको हम दोबारा याद करके अपने आप को रीडेडिकेट करें. वो जिस किस्म की शख्सियत थी, द प्लूरल इंडिया दैट ही स्टूड फॉर, उसकी याद हम आज ताज़ा कर रहे थे. और आई थिंक दैट वाज द मोस्ट इम्पॉर्टेंट थिंग दैट वी वर डूइंग हियर.
लोग पेन फाउंटेन पेन होते जा रहा था, एग्जीबिशन है, क्या कहेंगे इस बारे में भी? कैफी साहब जुड़े रहते थे फाउंटेन पेन.
भाई जो लास्ट इमेज था कैफी साहब का, जहाँ पर वो अपने फाउंटेन पेन के साथ खेल रहे हैं, बिल्कुल ऐसे लग रहे थे जैसे बच्चा खिलौनों के साथ खेलता है. वो मासूमियत, वो पाकीज़गी दोबारा कहीं पर हम अपने अंदर जगाएं, बिकॉज इन दिस एज ऑफ कम्युनिकेशन कहीं पर हम एक दूसरे से कट गए हैं. शायद ऐसे अपना मौके से हम दोबारा इसको रीइग्नाइट कर पाएं.
हो गया जी, हो गया जी कहीं. अब वो गए, जो गए अभी, चलो आगे चलो. हाँ देखिए, मैं समझता हूँ कि जो भी कैफी साहब को जानता है और उनका जो पेन से रिश्ता था और जो मोहब्बत थी वो जानता है, तो ये बहुत फितरी बात है और स्वाभाविक है कि हम पेन को देखें तो कैफी साहब का ख्याल आए, और जब कैफी साहब के बारे में सोचें तो पेन भी याद आए. तो ये बड़ा उन दोनों का बड़ा गहरा रिश्ता रहा है. और वो तो जो राइटर होता है, पोएट होता है, कहानीकार होता है, कलम ही उसका औजार भी है और कलम ही उसका हथियार भी है. तो आज एक पेन जो है उनके नाम डेडिकेट किया गया है और हम लोगों को दिया गया है, ये बड़ी खुशी की बात है और अच्छी बात है.
आज का ऐसा टाइम है जावेद जी, कि आप हर सवालों का जवाब देते हैं. आज का ऐसा टाइम आया है, लोग उसी कलम से लिखते हैं और बोलते हैं कि आमिर खान हैं, नसीरुद्दीन शाह जो ऐसे एक्टर हैं, इन्हें सम्मान के लायक नहीं है।
जो लोग लिखते हैं वो सम्मान के लायक हैं क्या? वही नहीं है बेचारे, तो अब उनके बारे में क्या सोचा जाए? पहले तो वो सम्मान के लायक बने, फिर बताए ना कि कौन सम्मान के लायक है कौन सम्मान के लायक नहीं है। तो जो लोग खुद ही सम्मान के लायक नहीं है वो थोड़ी सर्टिफिकेट दे सकते हैं कि कौन सम्मान के लायक है कौन नहीं है। कौन है? कुछ भी नहीं है वो।
मैडम जी,
इस आज के इस मौके पर आप कैसे याद करती हैं?
देखिए, मैं जो हूँ इंडिया पेन फेस्टिवल को, विलियम पेन को, विशाल सिंह को, कालके को, जिन्होंने इसको इकट्ठा किया, उनको बहुत मुबारकबाद देती हूँ। क्योंकि आज के दौर में जब सब सिर्फ कंप्यूटर इस्तेमाल करते हैं, बच्चे तो भूल भी गए और फिर उसमें बॉल पेन इस्तेमाल कर रहे थे, फाउंटेन पेन कितनी खूबसूरत चीज़ है और आपकी हैंडराइटिंग ठीक करने के लिए कितना ज़रूरी है। ये पेन फेस्टिवल एक बार फिर हमको रीइंट्रोड्यूस कर रहा है फाउंटेन पेन से, और उसका केंद्र बिंदु अब्बा यानी कैफ़े आज़मी साहब को बनाया है, क्योंकि ये उनके 100 सेंटेनरी सेलिब्रेशन हैं। और कैफ़े साहब को मटीरियल चीज़ों से कोई दिलचस्पी नहीं थी, उनको सिर्फ अपने कम्युनिस्ट पार्टी का कार्ड, उनकी किताबें और उनके 18 मोब्लांग पेन्स थे, बस सिर्फ वही उनकी कुलियात जिसको आप कहते हैं उसका ख़जाना था। और इन्होंने कैफ़े साहब को ये ट्रिब्यूट पे किया है, आई थिंक इट्स वेरी बिफिटिंग एंड एज ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ द फैमिली आई एम वेरी ग्रेटफुल। थैंक यू।
आज का ऐसा टाइम आ गया है, लोग उसी पेन से लिखते हैं कि आमिर खान एंड नसीरुद्दीन शाह जैसे एक्टर देश में सम्मान के लायक नहीं है, तो क्या कहना चाहेंगे आप?
देखिए, ये मायूस नहीं होना चाहिए, क्योंकि हमेशा ऐसा होता है कि अटैक किया जाता है, लेकिन जब आप अटैक करते हैं और जब ऐसा लगता है कि रात बहुत अंधेरी है, तो समझिए कि सुबह होने को भी है।
This way we go straight. From here.
Start from here,
sir. आज आपको देख के इतनी खुशी हो रही है, वे क्या बता रहे हैं?
Sorry. यहाँ से या बम्बई से लाके तो दे सकते हैं।